أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I begin in the name of the Almighty God, the Compassionate, the Merciful, the one who has created everything in utmost perfection. And may the peace and blessings of the Almighty God be upon His pure and beloved Messenger, the peak of humanity, the Holy Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon him and his immaculate progeny of the Ahlul Bayt, especially the leader of our time, the awaited Savior, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajah. May Allah hasten his reappearance and make us all amongst his sincere and dedicated servants. As we continue our exploration into the first general ziyarah of Al-Imam Al-Husayn, peace be upon him, we come across this passage which encourages us to be true slaves and servants of Aba Abdullah Al-Husayn. This passage reads in the first general ziyarah of the Imam alayhi salam. Al-Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam is teaching us. That's how you address your master, Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam. You address him by saying, Ana Abdullah, I am the slave of Allah, so that no one accuses us of committing shirk or that we do not follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أنا عبد الله ومولاك. And I am your servant, O Aba Abdullah. وفي طاعتك, I am in your obedience. والوافد إليك, I have come to you to visit you. I have come to migrate towards you, as we explained a few nights ago. As a believer, one must make the necessary effort to migrate to Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam. When we usually think of the servants of Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam, the companions of the Imam, usually we think of men, brave warriors who sacrificed their lives in the way of Abi Abdullah Al-Husayn. However, based on this passage, that we should be truly humble servants of the Imam alayhi salam, there is one category of people whom we usually are oblivious to, that they can also be true companions of Al-Imam Al-Husayn, and they were companions of the Imam alayhi salam. Just as the men sacrificed with bravery, with courage, with sincerity, they also sacrificed. And they played an instrumental role in the revolution of the Imam alayhi salam. Women who stepped up to the plate and they acted as noble leaders. They mobilized people for the sake of Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam. You know, the second most common misconception about the religion of Islam in the West is that the religion of Islam is anti-woman. It's a religion that marginalizes women. You know, there is some truth to that. Not the religion of Islam, but Muslims. There's a lot of truth to that. When you look at the history of Muslim societies and cultures, we do see that women are marginalized. This is not something to ignore or deny. The religion of Islam is one thing, but Muslim practice is another thing. When you examine the position of women historically in Muslim societies, we see that sometimes they have been marginalized. Our societies, our cultures have not done enough in order to encourage women to become active leaders in society. And oftentimes we place impediments, even if they want to be active leaders in our society, there are many impediments. We don't encourage them, especially in many of the cultures that you see in the Middle East. Those cultures do not encourage women to become active leaders in society. So there's a lot of truth to that. But that applies to Muslims, those who claim to be following the religion of Islam. It does not apply to the religion itself. You know, interestingly, once I was having this conversation with this non-Muslim woman, and she was telling me that my impression of the religion of Islam is that it does marginalize women. It's a religion that's anti-woman. She didn't say that Muslims don't adhere to your faith and they marginalize women. She said the religion itself marginalizes women. I said to her something, she had no reply. It is as if it was the first time for her hearing this. I told her, when you look at the statistics and the numbers of converts to the religion of Islam here in the United States or in Canada, when you look at the ratio of female converts to the religion of Islam, you see that it is higher than male converts to Islam. In some states, 2/3 of all converts are females. In some other states, 3/4, we're talking about 75% of converts being females. So if you have 100 converts, 75 of them are female. I asked her, why do you think so? If this is a religion that suppresses women, marginalizes women, does not give them their rights, why are more women embracing this religion? What does that tell you? This statistic in itself reveals to you that what we're told in the media is false, or these Muslim cultures, they don't represent the essence of the faith of Islam. Why would so many women who live in the West, who have freedom, why would they join and embrace a religion that supposedly takes away their rights? That doesn't make sense. The fact, the very fact that the majority of converts are women tells you a lot about the religion of Islam. That it's a religion that protects women, gives them honor, and gives them dignity, and elevates their status. But most people have this misconception that it's the religion of Islam that is marginalizing women. I remember once at the University of Michigan, I was taking a class, the sociology of women in the religion of Islam. The teacher asked the students, many of them were Americans, were non-Muslims. The teacher said, I want to see a show of hands. How many of you think or believe that Islam oppresses women and advocates for violence? Because on that day she was discussing domestic violence. She said, I want to see a show of hands. How many of you think that Islam advocates domestic violence? Half of those students raised their hands, thinking that Islam actually advocates violence. And then she asked them a second question. She told her class, and I was there present in the class, how many of you know a Muslim woman, a Muslim female? Everyone raised their hands because they had come across a Muslim. They either had Muslim friends or they knew someone who knew a Muslim. So when everyone admitted that they know of a Muslim family, of a Muslim woman, she asked the third question, which was an interesting question. She asked them, how many of you know personally a Muslim woman who's oppressed, who's subject to domestic violence, or you know someone who knows them? Not a single person raised their hand. She told them, see, this is what the media does. Half of you raised your hands saying that Muslim women, they're marginalized, they're oppressed, and they're subject to domestic violence. But when I ask you if you know anyone personally, you don't. Because the reality is, this is being exaggerated. Yes, there is domestic violence in Muslim communities. This is not something to deny. But domestic violence is not a problem of Islam or Muslim communities. It's a global problem. Everywhere you go in the world, you have the problem of domestic violence. Here in the United States, every year, over 5 million women, 5 million, can you imagine, are subject to domestic violence abusive relationships with their partners, where they're being beaten and assaulted. And 1/5 of all these assaults involve a weapon. We're talking about 1 million American women in the United States who are assaulted with a weapon. Look at the domestic violence statistics here in this country. 33% of all women, they admit once in their lifetime, they have been assaulted. They've been subject to domestic violence. Every single day, the domestic violence hotline receives 20,000 phone calls from women seeking help because they have an abusive partner. Every 9 seconds, as I'm speaking to you, every 9 seconds, a woman is being assaulted in the United States. And every single day, 3 are murdered. Every single day, 3 women in the United States are murdered due to domestic violence. So please don't come and tell me that this is the problem of Islam, of Muslim communities. This is a global problem. Any society you go to, domestic violence is an issue. Why blame and pinpoint at the religion of Islam? Now, in those Muslim communities where they claim there are higher rates of domestic violence, if that's proven, I tend to dispute that, but if it's proven that the rate is higher, this has nothing to do with the religion of Islam. It has to do to 2 factors. Number 1, ignorance, lack of education. Lack of education does increase domestic violence. That's number 1. Number 2, poverty. Poverty has also been proven to increase the level of domestic violence. Has nothing to do with the religion of Islam. The religion of Islam is very strict when it comes to domestic violence. Hence, we have a narration from the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. This narration states, any man who is abusive to his wife, who harms her, bothers her, or commits any act of injustice to her, you know what the consequence is? The hadith says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept his salah, his fasting, and anything he donates in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be accepted, and he will be the first person to be taken to hellfire. This is the religion of Islam. Another hadith states, the one who raises his hand to hit his wife, to batter his wife, then right there a hand in hell shall be raised for him. These are the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, and the Prophet. The religion of Islam denounces domestic violence. Why is the religion of Islam held responsible? But this is what the media does. When you examine the history of humankind, brothers and sisters, there is no family in the history of humanity who empowered women, who encouraged them to be leaders, who protected their rights like the family of Ahlul Bayt. You will not find any other family who elevate the status of women like they do. From the very first days of the religion of Islam, when you had Lady Khadija alayhi salam. You know, once I was having another conversation with a non-Muslim woman, and she had a lot of misconceptions about the religion of Islam. I told her one thing, because she thought that Muslim women have to stay at home. They can't work. They're locked up. They have no freedom. They have no social lives, no economic lives. I told her something. I told her, look, 14 centuries ago, there was a woman by the name of Khadija, peace be upon her. This woman was a very wealthy businesswoman. She had caravans. She had camels. She would exchange goods from one city to another city. She was a very affluent woman. Now, this lady, she was looking for a trustworthy man to work in her company, to go on business trips. And she found a trustworthy man in the city of Mecca. After a while, when she realized how well he behaved, how noble this man, a man of character, excellent character, she came and she proposed to him. And he accepted to marry her. Do you know who that was? He's like, no, who could that be? I told her, that's our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not marry a woman who was locked up in her house, who had no clue what's going on outside, or had no clue how to conduct business. His first and most favorite wife was a wife who was a businesswoman. This is the religion of Islam. You want more empowerment than that? The Prophet of God, who is a role model for humanity, he chose his first and most beloved wife to be a woman who was empowered, who was free, who had a huge business. Don't come and tell me that the religion of Islam advocates for a woman to be locked up in her house, have nothing to do with the world. Look at the history of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. And in those early days, this great religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look, we're talking about the final religion, the best, most comprehensive religion. And the Prophet says, one primary reason why this religion is successful is because of the sacrifices of Khadija. Buni al-Islamu ala mali Khadija. Show me empowerment more than that, brothers and sisters. For the Prophet to attribute the success of a global religion, of God's last religion, to a woman. Show me empowerment more than that. Show me praise more than that. Show me elevation more than that. The Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, played a crucial role in encouraging women to be leaders, to be active members of their society. And on this evening, I want to share with you an example and use this as an example that serves as the basis for this argument that the religion of Islam, that the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, and Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, when we address him, oh Abba Abdullah, I'm your servant, I'm migrating towards you. This example demonstrates that we need to encourage the female members of our society to be as leaders. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects them to be active leaders in society. Not only for us to, you know, respect them, give them the rights. No, they must be active leaders in our society. Let's go to this amazing example. And I'm pretty confident most of us have not even heard about this amazing figure from the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. Normally, we are told that when Imam al-Mahdi went into occultation, how many deputies did he have? We are told that he had four deputies, four ambassadors, right? Well, that is true. He did have four male deputies. But essentially, the Imam alayhi salam had a fifth deputy. He had a fifth ambassador. Ahmad ibn Ibrahim was one of the close companions of Imam al-Askari and Imam al-Hadi. Al-Shaykh al-Tusi and the Shaykh al-Saduq narrate this hadith in their books, an authentic hadith. They say Ahmad ibn Ibrahim, who was, by the way, a scholar, and he had books, he says in the year 282, in the Hijri calendar, that's 22 years after Al-Ghaybat al-Sughra started, the minor occultation of